Disclaimer, I do not dislike CinemaSins, and that is not a lie. For my next Everything Wrong with CinemaSins video, I'm going to be sending their video on Escape Room. Enjoy the video, everyone.
47 seconds of inescapable logos.
Jeremy complains about the logos cliche.
Somehow, out of all the things in this room, this random rolled-up poster in a box of many posters contains the first big clip.
This is just you saying what has just happened in the movie.
All the light.
Yeah, but that required the room to knock the light over for him. I know we're in an escape room designed by Jigsaw, but this is the only room in the movie that requires the killing mechanism to begin before the player is directed where to go.
Actually, that's not true. The oven room also directed the group where to go after it was turned on. Before it was turned on, the group was at a dead end. Afterwards, Zoe opened the frosted window and the call gave them a hint about following the posted rules.
Green! Great book!
How green was my valley? Shakespeare in love! Oh, sorry, I thought we were yelling out undeserving Oscar winners.
Jeremy says something random cliche.
In case you confused it for Chicago, the musical.
Pretty sure no one did.
This is movie code for we knew the first 20 minutes of this movie would be boring as so we began with something towards the end of the story so you f***ers wouldn't pass out.
Well, I think that people would be interested in finding out more about what they just saw with Ben.
Atoms won't change while you watch them.
Kids, pay attention in class, because every single time a movie character is shown in class, they learn something that helps them out of a huge jam later.
That happens in a lot of movies, so that isn't a sin of this movie.
So wait, was that whole previous scene a dream? Or was she having an actual hallucination and then later woke up from a nightmare we didn't see? If you're going to put in the effort to foreshadow some character backstory, maybe don't make it so confusing.
Judging by Zoe waking up, I think we could easily see that it was a dream.
Also, if this is a dream, this has got to be the most normal dream ever committed to film. I mean, she even dreams about walking through her dorm while a party rages. No wonder she got fired from Cobb's Inception Company.
Jeremy says something random cliche.
Amanda Harper's height is 5'40". New math suggests that she's over 8 feet tall.
One, nothing in this movie suggests Amanda is 8 feet tall. Two, Deborah Ann Woll is 5 feet tall in reality.
Also, this number at the bottom of the license contains entirely too many 7s, 6s, and 3s to be anywhere near f***ing real.
Pointing things out on the screen.
I'll sneak in a second one.
Minos, which is setting up escape rooms to kill people with troubled pasts and doesn't want any proof they exist after the fact, couldn't detect that this kid had another phone.
If the movie is saying that the Minos people didn't notice Danny with another phone, then that's what happened.
It could be anything, anywhere.
It's crazy to me that the guy who's been in 80,000 escape rooms in his life looks under the table first and inside the kitchen cabinets, when there are magazines and books everywhere in this room that are more likely to contain clues.
I mean, have you never been to an escape room? Sometimes they'll have clues hidden inside something, or on the floor. I mean, I did this escape room once, and there was a key hidden in a fake plant, and this escape room was in the dark. Also, I get that you're exaggerating when you say 80,000 escape rooms, but Danny said that he'd been to 93 escape rooms.
There are interesting parallels between this movie and David Fincher's The Game, for sure, but this is that pickup artist book by Neil Strauss. Why not have the novel based on the movie?
Pointing things out on the screen.
So, we're looking for screws?
No, again, that was the subject of Neil Strauss's The Game. You're losing focus, movie.
Amanda just said that because Mike found a screwdriver, so I'd say that the movie is not losing its focus.
The problem with a lot of these fake puzzles is that they often aren't progressive, meaning you don't have to do one thing to unlock another. It's clever that each room is meant to play into someone's backstory, but the way this room is designed, you could escape it without actually ever turning the oven on.
Yeah, it's possible. But they did turn the oven on, so why is this a sin?
The movie will have you believe that Danny crawled through this duct in 4 seconds, and I'm not having it.
Firstly, it was actually 10 seconds. And secondly, if the movie is saying Danny could crawl that fast, then it's what happened.
There's no signal.
And the fact that Danny snuck a phone into this escape room never comes up again. What was the point of him sneaking in a phone if it didn't become important later?
Danny previously told Amanda that he always sneaks in a second phone because the waiting rooms can get boring.
And the Slumdog Millionaire Award for escaping a room based on prior life experience goes to Ben.
Jeremy says something random cliche.
You'll go down in history!
Man, Tennessee has officially gone overboard by sticking their Don't Drive Drunk commercials in the middle of Saw movies.
This movie was not filmed in Tennessee, my dude.
It's Rudolph.
This is not only the easiest puzzle, it's also the most curious one in the entire movie. What was the danger? Could they have died? Maybe the game makers are throwing a curveball onto that last one where they nearly died, and everybody will think that everything's on the up and up after this, but what's the point of that?
Actually, the cabin isn't a separate room. It's connected to the frozen lake.
They want us to fight over limited resources.
Not gonna work this time, okay?
This time? What do you mean this time? You've been in two rooms, and neither of them asked the players to share limited resources.
What Amanda meant by this time was that she thinks Minos has made people fight over limited resources before.
It just feels like I'm playing the world's funnest game with the world's meanest people.
Twitter.
Not a sin there, my dude.
I just climbed a tree for like the first time in my goddamn life.
Yeah, that's incredible. Most people can't do it if they haven't practiced. And I know you want to seem helpful and shit, but why didn't you ask the others if they had tree climbing experience before trying it yourself?
I mean, pine trees aren't that hard to climb.
Something I'm good at. You mean you can stand over a hole and hold a stick?
Man, no wonder this guy was never promoted to a cash register job at a grocery store. He's a dick for absolutely no reason. Well, this is the second time he's just randomly dictified the proceedings.
This is one of those cases of use in characterization, as Ben does grow into a better person over the course of this film.
Thanks a lot.
Is the movie suggesting that somehow the Watchers knew that this lighter would be tossed on the ice, and that Danny would be the one to pick it up at this exact point? Or is this a natural ice break that just happened to take Danny and the lighter down? Either way, I'm suggesting the new title for the movie be Convenience Room.
There have been two theories to this. The first is that this was Danny's punishment for sneaking his phone in. The second is that anyone could have walked over to get Ben's lighter, and Danny just happened to be the one to do it.
Many of these people would have frostbite by the end of this nonsense. Whoever is wearing the coat should have that thing in the coat while breathing on it and using their core temperature to warm it up. And there is at least one would-be physicist here who would know to do that.
And to make your point, you cut out that Mike hugs the ice block when wearing the coat. Good job.
And why the hell are you melting it evenly on every side? Just melt a hole straight to the key. These are the most stupid randomly assembled stereotypes ever to be randomly assembled in stereotyping.
Probably not easy for five people to melt a hole to one spot all at once with their hands.
Guys, I've seen so many movies. Is this Escape Room? Or is this that last Tomb Raider movie where Ex Machina played Lara Croft?
The drop in Tomb Raider was over water. This one is not.
I guess it's a good thing that they have the army chick and that she didn't die in the previous puzzles, so that she can climb this impossible upside down bar. No one else could have done this, and I find that to be tremendously poor sportsmanship on the part of the psychotic escape room creators.
Actually, Jason is also pretty strong, as evidenced by him hanging onto the wall after the second floor piece falls and almost takes him with it.
Jason! It then takes five cuts to show True Blood throw a fastball to Insecure, and I don't believe for 1 minute it was successful. But the movie is telling me it is. Anyway, I sure know my HBO, don't I?
Oh, how ironic. You just answered yourself.
Can you stop being a dick?
I guess I'm going to sin human behavior that happens all the time, but of all the people to ask another person to stop being a dick, it's this guy, who's been a dick for no reason at least 3 times in this movie.
I'll admit that you're not wrong here, but Ben has shown sadness over losing Amanda and Danny, while Jason hasn't. I mean, after Danny died, Jason was more concerned about losing Ben's lighter.
They made these rooms for us.
The poetic nature of the rooms loses a lot of steam when certain players could die before they even get to their personalized room, though. What if Ben died in the first room with the oven? Then he doesn't get to the second room, which related to him.
One, this isn't a sin since Ben didn't die in the oven room. Two, as I previously said, the cabin was a part of the frozen lake. They were not separate rooms.
You're not listening to me!
You gotta love how the nerdy girl thinks she can convince 3 dudes without any quantum physics knowledge that she's right about smashing the cameras when there's 3 minutes left on the clock. The movie wants us to empathize with her character because she's probably right, but come on, her out-of-nowhere idea with 3 minutes left is too little too late.
That's not what Zoe is trying to do. She realized the game's purpose before the timer was shown, and she believes that they can escape without being watched. That's why she's smashing the cameras.
The strings! Maybe they mean the low end!
All this time, the thinking was, maybe if we get someone's heart rate high enough, that'll solve the clue. And now Jason realizes that testing your limits might mean finding a lower heart rate.
I mean, Jason has tried and failed 3 times to open the door with a high heart rate, so him trying to get a lower one makes sense to me.
Feel free to leave.
But may we know it's best to finally...
It's good to see the writers of the poems from the original Jumanji are still finding work.
Jeremy says something random cliche.
Also, this room is yet another one completely left to chance. What if only one of them had opened it, or others were still with them? Or they thought to put some clothes on their hands for grip, or maybe even searched around a while before they found the hatch.
One, you are, yet again, sending this movie for things that did not happen. Two, the hatch was easy to find in the room. Jason just was looking around and then he happened to notice it on the floor.
The drug trippy room is another curious addition to the escape room's theme of building a room for each player. The only person this relates to is Ben, but he already had the reindeer room.
You are right that the illusion room relates to Ben, and it is his room, but my sin here is saying, yet again, that the cabin was not a separate room.
And now I'm wondering which room was Mike's. He died in the last room when Jason tried to speed up his heart rate. His story was that he survived a cave-in at a mine. None of the rooms had anything to do with that. And Danny totally missed the poisonous gas room made for him because he's dead.
Mike's room was the one where the walls closed in on Ben, mimicking how Mike almost died during the mine cave-in. Also, you were correct on which room was Danny's, but I'm going to show you this on screen for more clarifications on which room was whose.
And we're back to the beginning of the movie. And not in a cool Llewyn Davis kind of way, either. More of a really annoying Sisyphus kind of way, if I'm being honest.
Jeremy says something random cliche.
Also, she takes out both of these orange suits with one IV pole? I mean, those dudes are out cold, and I'm pretty sure she just hit one of them a single time in the middle of the back.
If the movie is saying that that's possible, then that's what happened.
Boy, the movie sure has kicked into high yada yada gear for these last few escapes, huh? So he was being crushed, but just used a shield to hide in the fireplace, and that did the trick.
Yes, and see the previous sin.
The idea that this kind of thing could be going on at this level for many years without anyone finding out about it is almost more unbelievable and upsetting than the fact that this movie made more money than The Shawshank Redemption, A Simple Plan, Clue, and Children of Men combined. That's right, I said Clue.
The fact that this movie made more money than other movies isn't something wrong with it.
Unless you had lung survivors.
The more I hear about this game, the more I realize that they did pick these specific six people to open a puzzle box and RSVP an escape room. They didn't throw out 1,000 invitations hoping to get a handful. They targeted these people. So what happens if a few of them don't want to play?
For like the fifth time, that did not happen.
The Game Master is now part of the game. Man, this movie just went from bananas to insane fruit salad. Nothing like watching a movie with a solid concept and mediocre execution decide to shoot for finishing as B-movie schlock.
Sending something you like.
Also, if you have the power to do all that, wouldn't it have been easier to just send a couple of goons to kill Zoe and Ben as they slowly limped out of the building? Or is Mino/Sony this dedicated to making a sequel to The Escape Room?
This isn't another what if this happens sins, but again, that didn't happen.
Well, at least the movie knows when to end. Damn it!
Thoughts ain't a sin, my dude.
We beat them at their own game.
Well, technically you survived their game. To beat them at their own game, you'd have to trap them in a death trap with you and then win. So maybe slow down with the bravado there, nerdy chick.
The Minos website said that no one had ever escaped the rooms, meaning that they all died, even though the sequel proves otherwise, so I'd say that Zoe has a point. And here's the end result, everybody. This in total was 124, and the sentence will be, no way out. Thank you for watching, everybody, and happy Halloween.